Hey, thanks for joining us at Eden Worship Center for our online service. Here's what I want to ask you to do. Let's treat this time that we're about to spend together as sacred and set apart to the Lord. So right now, put away all the other distractions that are around you and begin to press into God. Sing like you're in the room and pray like you're in the room and dive into God's word like you're in the room. So right now, go and grab your Bible. We believe it's the word of God that does the work of God in the people of God. So have it in your hand. If you're from another congregation of believers, we're glad you're joining us. We hope you're blessed by this time we're about to spend together, gathered around God's word. But we hope that that's just supplemental to what you're getting in that local church. You need to be investing your time and talent and treasure there. Right now, together, let's ask that God would open our eyes to see Jesus clearly. That we would see ourselves, our sin clearly, that the gospel might look beautiful, that God would be glorified and our hearts and lives would be changed.
And we will. All right, good morning, church. Good morning, welcome. Come on in. Let's stand together as we worship. I want to just read to you from Psalm 34. Call to worship. Verse 1 says, I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. My soul makes its boast in the Lord. Let the humble hear and be glad. Oh, magnify the Lord with me and let us exalt his name together. The angel of the Lord encamps around those who fear him and delivers them. Oh, taste and see the Lord is good. Blessed is the man who takes refuge in him. Oh, fear the Lord, you saints, for those who fear him lack nothing. God, as we come to gather as your people to worship, we pray that you would lift our eyes and fix them on Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith. God, we pray that our hearts would be anchored in the truth of who he is and lifted in exaltation and worship for his great majesty that we ask, oh God, put on display today. Let us see Jesus in the word. Let us see Jesus as we sing true things about him and let our hearts fall in surrender before him. God, this time is yours. We set it apart for you. We ask you to bless it and use it to draw your people closer to yourself. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, last week we talked about what it is to come to God, to give of ourselves to him. That it's more than just coming on a Sunday morning to receive something, that it's actually us giving of our hearts and soul and time and talent and treasure to the Lord. So let's just sing this song together as we make an offering of ourselves to him.
The sun cannot compare to the glory of your love.
There's no shadow.
There is no shadow in your presence. No mortal man would dare to stand before your throne, before the Holy One of heaven. God, it's only by your blood, and it's only through your mercy, Lord, I come. We bring an offering of worship to my King. No one on earth deserves the praises that we sing. Jesus, may you receive the honor your due. Oh Lord, I bring an offering to you.
All of ourselves, God. The sun cannot compare.
The sun cannot compare to the glory of your love. There is no shadow in your presence. No mortal man would dare to stand stand before your throne, before the Holy One of heaven. God, it's only by your blood. Yes, it's only through your mercy, Lord, I come. Worship to our King. No one on earth deserves the praises that we sing. Jesus, may you receive the honor that you're due. Oh Lord, we bring an offering to you. I bring. I bring an offering of worship to my King. No one on earth deserves the praises that I sing. Jesus, may you receive the honor that you're due. Oh Lord, I bring.
Just sing that again. I bring an offering. This is so important as God's people gather to worship in a day and age that demands our affection, our affiliation, our devotion to all the things of this world. And God stands above all of them and says, I'm the only one who's worthy. The only one who's worthy for us to devote our lives to. So God, as your people, we say, let this be more than words on our lips. Let it be our heart responding to you. It says no matter what happens in the world with this virus, no matter what happens in the world with this election, you alone demand my worship. You alone hold my hope.
So I bring an offering of worship to my King. No one on earth deserves the praises that I sing. Jesus, may you receive the honor that you're due. Oh Lord, I bring. Offering,
we bring ourselves, Lord, one more time.
And I bring an offering of worship to my King. No one on earth deserves the praises that I sing. Jesus, may you receive the honor that you're due. Oh Lord, I bring an offering to you.
Lord, I bring.
Oh Lord, I bring an offering to you.
We bring ourselves.
And oh Lord, I bring an offering to you. Bring an offering.
God, all that we have, all that we are, is a good and gracious gift from you. I pray as your people, we would rightfully respond by surrendering ourselves, surrendering all that we have and saying, God, use us. Use our lives, use our fortunes, use our families for the sake of your gospel in this earth. Forgive us for just looking at ourselves. Forgive us, God, for even coming into this room this morning wondering what this service would offer to us. Oh, God, let us get it right and say, God, we've come to offer ourselves to you. Be exalted in the worship of your people, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. You may be seated. Well, welcome. We are glad that you are here to worship with us. What a privilege it is. And we should not forget that. It is a privilege for God's people to gather together. I was just having a conversation before the service began about other places in the world where, because of situations going on and governments that are directly opposed to the gospel, churches are absolutely banned from meeting. What a privilege it is for us to gather as saints, as those who have been redeemed to God by the precious blood of Jesus Christ. So we are thankful for that. We want to just acknowledge something that we are missing out on this morning, though, and that is, this is normally the day that we would commemorate Patriot Sunday, Patriot Day, the Sunday closest to 9/11. We have set aside for the last 19 years to honor, to remember, to pray for not only peace in our nation, but our first responders that serve our community and those around us. And so we want to just tell you what we did. We did things a little bit different. We waited until the absolute last minute that we could before we made the decision. But as we prayerfully considered how do we honor our first responders, one of the things that we kept coming back to is it wise to then take all of our community's first responders and stick them in one room at one time where if somebody happens to come in and expose them to this virus, we've just taken out all of our local responding police and firemen. We thought that sounded like a bad idea. Maybe not a great way to honor them. So Pastor John made up a whole bunch of individualized cards with their names on it, just thanking them for serving, thanking them for being part of what Romans 13 says is God's blessing for our community. Sent that out. We sent them a small gift card to just sort of get out of the house. Anybody else felt a little stir crazy, stuck inside your house a lot? Yeah. So just get out a little bit, go to Dairy Queen, and then we had some challenge coins made up that have the Eden Worship Center logo on it. Now, how many of you know what challenge coins are in here? All right, a handful. So we'll show them to you afterwards. It's kind of a popular thing in military and police and firefighters. It has the Eden Worship Center logo with the five solas of the Reformation on there, that we are saved by grace alone, through faith alone, in Christ alone, as revealed in Scripture alone, to the glory of God alone. And on the back, it has Ephesians verse on there, just reminding them that we're not saved by our good works. It is the grace of God that saved us. So we took that to all the departments on September 11th. We had a video. Pastor Richard Hartman, a pastor and the lead chaplain down in Fort Wayne for the Fort Wayne Police Department, was going to be here this morning, but we changed plans and went down and recorded a video. And we actually posted that video on the morning of September 11th at 8:46 a.m. when the first plane hit the first tower, just to commemorate that moment that sort of changed all of our lives, changed the way we think about the world around us. If you haven't seen that, you can go to the church's Facebook page or church's YouTube page and check that out. But we wanted to just mention that so that you know we are still doing something intentionally to bless our first responders and to honor them. And would you just join me? Let's just pause. We normally call them in and pray for them and bless them. Would you just join me as we pray for our first responders, for those who have served in the military and those who are currently serving in the military, those who are doing what is necessary to keep our community and our nation safe. Can we just stop and pray for God's blessing on them? God, right now, we thank you that you, O sovereign God, are not hindered or limited by a virus. We just sang it. There is no shadow of turning in your presence. You are the same yesterday, today, and forever, which means this moment does not shake you. This moment has not disturbed your eternal peace or thwarted your eternal plan. And at the same time, we know it's true that our plans feel very shaken. And so we thank you, Lord, for an opportunity to reach out and bless our first responders. We pray that you would bless them and keep them, that you would make your face shine upon them. You would be gracious to them. Lord, you would protect them as they serve in their duties, whether it is
police officers or firefighters or EMTs or those serving in the military, we pray, oh God, would you stand guard around them who stand guard around us. Lord, watch over them. Watch over their families, we pray. Watch over their marriages, we pray, and their children, we pray. God, we know the risk that comes in serving in those capacities, and we pray, God, would you cause them, not let them, not we hope it's true. We pray, oh sovereign God, cause them to trust in you. When their hearts want to trust in everything else they see in this world, we pray, Lord, make them trust in you. Reveal yourself as the only option, the only anchor for their lives. And I pray that you would save them, and I pray that you would fill them with strength as they serve. We pray your blessing upon them in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. All right, well, a couple other announcements in the bulletin that we have. We're going to have a couple more work days at the end of this month. Thank you so much to everybody who has come out and helped with the work projects that are going on out at this incredible blessing of an old building. We need to have both of those things in balance. This building is a great blessing near fortress, but it's old and it's got some stuff going on. So thank you for those who have helped. Thank you for those who are going to come out September 9th, 19th and 26th. Usually we've been doing those in the morning, anytime 8 or 9 in the morning, up till noonish, somewhere around there. I saw Tim Cleveland had a significant list of things that he had posted that I shared as well. If you're on Facebook, check that out. If you're not, come and talk to myself or Tim or Ron Gingrich back in the back, and we'll kind of fill you in on some of the things that we're going to be working on. We need everybody's help to pull some of these things together, whether it is cleaning in the building or it's maybe you know how to fix the pipe that's currently leaking in the basement. Whatever it takes, we could use all of that help. No matter what your skill level, we'd be glad to have you help with that. One more thing that I think we should pray about. There's some reminders in your bulletin about just being cautious with each other, reminders to be praying for our missionaries like we did last week. But I think it would be good this morning if we just prayed for those whose lives are right now in turmoil. There's some things, whether it is protests and riots in the street or whether it is wildfires sweeping away entire communities whose lives right now feel really turned upside down. And to be really honest, my wife is at home with a kidney stone. And yet, as uncomfortable as that is, hi, honey, if you're watching, as uncomfortable as that is, the main thing we're currently worried about is lunch. We're not worried about will we have a home to go home to, or we don't have a home to go home to. What are we going to do? I think it is good for us to stop and entrust them into the hands of the sovereign God as well. Amen. So why don't you stand with me and let's pray. Lord, again, we acknowledge that this world so often falls short of our plans. How we would want things for our life, how we would wish things for our world or our nation or our community. And in those moments of desperation, whether it's desperation in the small things or catastrophic things, we stop and remind ourselves that you hold all things in the palm of your hand. That the Lord has purposed, who can thwart him? That you will accomplish all that you have said that you will do. And so we pray not only for our families and our community, we pray for families and community remote from us who we have never met, who right now their lives, their world, their family is in turmoil. And we pray, oh God, be near to the brokenhearted. Be near to those who are walking through desperate and dark times. Lord, and in their desperation, would you show them that you are the only hope? In the moment where they feel like they have lost everything, would you show them that you are the God of the unshakable kingdom, of that which cannot be burned, cannot be shaken? When all of that is gone, what remains is your solid, eternal kingdom. God, cause them to trust in you. We pray comfort. We pray provision for them in this moment. Right now, where they're walking, we pray, God, be near to them, surround them, provide for them.
Show us ways that we can be generous towards them. But God, what they need more than all of that is the closeness of your Holy Spirit. And so we say, draw near to them. And draw them near to yourself, we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Remain standing. Let's sing together. Man, here's the truth that we're about to sing. If we fix our eyes on this world, on the things going on around us, all the things that discourage us, maybe drag us down, I guarantee the result is going to be sadness, depression, despair, hopelessness. Oh, but if we fix our eyes on the living God, on the King of Kings who rules over nations and kingdoms and kings and presidents and you and me. Well, that's when our praise begins to rise before the throne of God and hope begins to rise within our hearts. So let's just sing this song.
Praise is rising, eyes are turning to you. We turn to you for hope is stirring, our hearts are yearning for you, long for you. 'Cause when we see you, we find strength to face the day. In your presence, all our fears are washed away. They're washed away. Hosanna, Hosanna. Oh, you are the God who saves us. You're worthy of all our praises. Hosanna. Oh, come have your way among us. We welcome you here, Lord Jesus. Hear the sound. Oh, hear the sound of hearts returning to you. We turn to you.
In your kingdom.
For your kingdom, broken lives are made new. You make us new. 'Cause when we see you, 'cause when we see you, we find strength to face the day. 'Cause in your presence, all our fears are washed away. God, wash away. Hosanna, Hosanna. Oh, you are the God who saves us. You're worthy of all our praises. Hosanna, Hosanna. Oh, come have your way among us. We welcome you here, Lord Jesus. When we see you, when we see you, we find strength to face the day.
Sing it again. When we see you,
when we see you, we find strength, God, to face the day. For in your presence, all our fears are washed away, washed away. So open the eyes of my heart, Lord,
to see you.
I want to see you. I want to see you.
Open the eyes.
Open the eyes of my heart, Lord.
Open up.
Open the eyes of my heart that I want to see you. And I want to see you.
Let's just sing it.
And open the eyes of my heart, Lord. God, open the eyes of my heart, cause I want to see you. Lord, I want to see you.
One more time.
And open the eyes of my heart.
Open up my eyes.
Open the eyes of my heart. God, I want to see you. I want to see you.
So when we see you.
Because when we see you, we find strength to face the day.
Thank you, Lord.
In your presence, all our fears are washed away. They're washed away. And Hosanna, Hosanna. You are the God who saves us. You're worthy of all our praises.
It's true.
And Hosanna. And Hosanna. Come have your way among us. We welcome you here, Lord Jesus. Oh, come have your way among us. Welcome you here, Lord Jesus. And Hosanna.
Oh God, we look to you, our only hope, our only strength, our only security is found in you. Oh God, we pray, help us trust you more. Lord, let it be true, and let it be even more true as our families put our hope in you, we pray. Amen. Amen. You may be seated. Well, we're glad you're here. We're glad your families are here. If you want to grab that little red folder, if you're sitting on the outside, it's just a piece of paper, and just help us track through the attendance. Let us know that you're here. There is something so important that I think happens when God's people gather that we're super grateful for live stream when it works. But we're super grateful for live stream, at least in some setting, but it's not the same. It's not the same as when your family is here, when you gather with God's people to lift up his name. It's not even the same as you gather to sit under the teaching of God's word. We believe that it's God's word that does God's work in God's people. But that really happens differently. We hear things differently when we're in the congregation than when we're in our living room. So if you're watching in your living room, I would just encourage you this morning, lean in. Lean in. Treat this time as sacred, as God's word is open before us. For those of us as families, let's lean into that idea that by bringing our families into these places, we are putting them under the power of God's word, under the influence of his Holy Spirit that guides us, that leads us into all truth. And so let's pray for them right now. Let's pray for God to do for our children what we cannot. We normally, if you're visiting with us, what we normally do is call all of our kids up and they sit up here on the stage and then we pray for them, we bless them, we send them off to classes. Because of the way things are right now, all of our kids are in here. So if you've brought kids into this room, we appreciate it. I'm going to do it one more time. If you've brought kids into this room, we appreciate it. It's true. It's true. Kids are noisy and restless, and that's a gift from God. Now, we can teach them to do a little better, right? It's true whether you say amen or not, right? It's okay. But we're glad that they are here. We're glad because we actually believe it's God's word that does the work in their hearts. So let's pray that his word does what we can't. So God, we pray for our boys and girls right now. We thank you for them. Oh God, what a gift they are to our family and to the family of believers. And we pray for those who are joined in that covenant of grace. God, as you are working in mom and dad's heart, through that you have joined these little ones to this family of believers, and we pray, God, would you meet with them on their level, right where they are. God, in the midst of things like taking notes on that paper or coloring on a page or just trying to maintain some sense of quietness in the row, I pray you would break through all of that and meet with their hearts. I pray you'd break through all of that and show them Jesus. Oh God, let their hearts see you and trust you and be saved, we pray. It's for your name, your honor, your glory, we ask it. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thanks, Matt, for what you said about the kids. It was bringing back a lot of memories for us. Some of you parents may be thinking, oh my goodness, how am I going to make it through a Sunday morning with my kids? Well, I was just thinking back in the days when Janice and I were on the road for 16 years. Matt and his brother were in church probably four nights a week and twice on Sunday. Believe it or not, you know Matt, so believe it or not, he's laughing. And my wife is laughing at home, too, watching this. But, they would sit in the church pew without moving and saying a word while Janice and I were up singing in the service. They knew that if they didn't, it was not going to be pleasant when mom got back or after the service. Things went well for a long time until we were in this one church where one dear grandma just felt so sorry for them. She's sitting two rows behind them going, psst, psst. Matt, I don't know if you remember that or not, but we're glad you're here. We're glad you're here with your kids. I shared with Matt a little bit. I'm just feeling so much emotion this morning. I watched a video of things that are going on in Oregon in a community that Janice and I were in so many times. And the entire community, every structure is gone because of the fires. So would you continue to pray for these people? You know, we think it's bad when a tornado comes through, and it is. But what's happening is far worse. And our firefighters out there on the first front lines just really need our prayers. If you got a bulletin when you came in, down in the notes section, you'll see something for family talk, family discussion time. Dads, I would encourage you to keep your bulletin handy and make some notes as we go along. If you're watching online, the family talk discussion will be at the end. And it'll be there for you. We're going to look in chapter 37 of Exodus this morning, if you'd open your Bible with me. As you're doing that, I read something by Dr. Paul Tripp that I thought was so profound, because we're going to look today at hopefully beginning to understand God's glory. Paul Tripp said, "No single drawing, painting, photograph, or verbal description can ever capture glory. Glory isn't so much a thing as it is a description of a thing. Glory isn't part of God. It is all that God is. Every aspect of who God is and every part of what God does is glorious. But even that is not enough of a description. Not only is he glorious in every way, but his very glory is glorious." And I would say to us that to understand the glory of God is to understand God. If you have your Bible open, would you stand with me one more time as we give honor to God's word? And we're going to read together, beginning in Exodus 37, verse 1. If it sounds a little different from your translation, I'm using the New American Standard. If you have the New American Standard and it still sounds different, it's because I can't read. All right, verse 1. Now, Bezalel made the ark of acacia wood. Its length was 2.5 cubits, its width 1.5 cubits, and its height was 1.5 cubits. A cubit was about 18 inches, by the way. Verse 2, and he overlaid it with pure gold inside and out, and made a gold molding for it all around. And he cast 4 rings of gold for it on its 4 feet, even 2 rings on one side of it and 2 rings on the other side of it. And he made poles of acacia wood and overlaid them with gold. And he put the poles into the rings of the sides of the ark to carry it. And he made a mercy seat of pure gold, 2.5 cubits length and 1.5 cubits wide. And he made 2 cherubims of gold. He made them of hammered work at the 2 ends of the mercy seat, 1 cherub at one end and 1 cherub at the other. And he made the cherubim of 1 piece from the mercy seat at its 2 ends. And the cherubims had their wings spread upward, covering the mercy seat with their wings. With their faces toward each other, the faces of the cherubims were towards the mercy seat. Let's pray. God, thank you for your word. Thank you for your glory that was revealed in the Old Testament and revealed even more clearly through the Lord Jesus Christ. Lord, would you open our eyes to see, our ears to hear, and our hearts to receive what you have for us today? Would you bless the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart? Let them be acceptable in your sight, O Lord. Let nothing bitter or critical come forth today, but let it be sweet water that gives life. For you're my strength and my redeemer. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. What we read in all of chapter 37, and obviously I didn't go through all of it this morning, in your family talk, you're going to read it all together. But what we see in chapter 37 is really a picture, almost word for word, of what God said in Exodus chapter 25. We'll see next week that when the tabernacle of Moses is completed, this tent of meeting, God gloriously descends over that tent of meeting in a cloud, and in the Holy of Holies, the glory of his presence comes down, that Shekinah glory that came down over the mercy seat. Try to picture it. Listen to what it says in chapter 40. Then the cloud over the tent of meeting and the glory of the Lord filled the tabernacle, and Moses was not able to enter the tent of meeting because the cloud had settled on it and the glory of the Lord filled the tabernacle. I would say to us, church, that we have become so accustomed to casual worship that we really don't understand what it means to come into the presence of the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, the Creator God of the universe. We wouldn't say it in so many words, but how frequently do we show up in church, and I'm not picking on anyone who's folding their hands right now, like Mike Drake. Oh. But how often have we come with an attitude that, well, you know, God, you are quite fortunate to have me as your child, after all. Now, we wouldn't say that in so many words, and yet with our casual attitude, let's be brutally honest. I'm telling you right now, this chapter has confronted me in ways that I don't like. But let's be brutally honest that in our casual approach to worship, we have lost a sense of the glory and the majesty and the fear of the Creator God of the universe. How dare we sit down and not fall on our faces before the living God. Now, I say all of that because I do enjoy our casual approach. The first time I showed up in church on a Sunday morning and wasn't wearing a tie, people thought revival had broken out. But let's be honest, church, we really have no sense of what the real glory of God is. As we look into this word, I want us to pay attention, and dads, pay attention to this because this is going to be a part of your discussion. We see here in these first 9 verses what's outlined about the Ark of the Covenant. Later on in the chapter, it talks, beginning in verse 10, the table of showbread, the golden candlestick, and the altar of incense. Each of these is incredibly significant. That Ark of the Covenant that's placed in the Holy of Holies, it was the single most important thing in Israel. Do you realize that if you go to the Holy Land today, and if you go to the Wailing Wall, they wail for 3 reasons. They wail over the destruction of the temple. They wail over the loss of the Ark of the Covenant, and they wail and they pray for the coming of the Messiah. Yet today, 2020, when King Saul is killed and the Ark of the Covenant is taken, they wail because the glory of God has departed from Israel. And it wasn't the death of the king. It was the loss of the Ark of the Covenant. Now, I have to restrain myself because I love to teach and to preach about the Ark of the Covenant and some of these glorious things in the Old Testament. But it's amazing to me. In the Holy of Holies, where the presence of God would come down over the mercy seat. I want you to think about something. Inside of that Ark of the Covenant, there were 3 things. Do you remember what they were? There was a jar of manna. There was the 10 Commandments and Aaron's budding rod. For a time, they put the golden serpent in there, the brazen serpent. But people started to worship it, and they took it out and ground it up and did some other good things with it. But I think it is amazing, it is glorious, that inside the Ark of the Covenant, which contained the law, it is covered by the mercy of God. Again, I have to restrain myself, because I could spend the rest of the morning just talking about this. If you ever have the opportunity to go to Lancaster, Pennsylvania, I believe that this full-size replica of the Tabernacle of Moses is still there. And what a great thing to do as a family to go through that and begin to see just a visual representation of what it would have been like. I will tell you right now that the items of gold that are outlined here in chapter 37 are gold spray paint. But what a powerful experience to go and see that. Because you see, there is so much in the Tabernacle of Moses that is a foreshadowing of the coming of Christ, who is the fulfillment of all of that. The table of showbread, 12 loaves of bread and wine, 12 loaves for the 12 tribes of Israel, symbolic of what we understand today in terms of communion. The golden candlestick, the only light in the inner court, symbolic of Jesus, the light of the world. And then there's the altar of incense, symbolic of Jesus, our great high priest, who ever lives to make intercession for us. Interests me that one of the primary ingredients in the incense that was used was frankincense, one of the things brought to Jesus as a child by the wise men. Symbolic of his ministry as a great high priest. I deeply appreciated how Matt Chandler handled this passage of Scripture. He points out that in chapter 25, the people hear the word of the Lord. And then in the chapters that follow, especially in chapter 32, they wrestle with that word and they rebel against that word. But here in chapter 37, they now obey that word. And in all of this, it's in the context of God forming a people for himself. And think about us. We're not so much different than the children of Israel. Most of us find ourselves going through the same stages that the children of Israel went through. God speaks to us. We wrestle with it. We rebel against it. We run from it. But, oh, the Holy Spirit will not let us go, and he continues to draw us back to bring us to that point of joyful obedience. The Bible says there's coming a day when every knee will bow and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. I used to think God's going to have to break a lot of knees to get people to fall on their faces. But the older I get, the more I am convinced that when we see the glory of God, there is nothing that we can do but fall on our faces before him. And I believe that sinners will go into their eternal punishment somewhat willingly because of the revelation of the glory of God. The revelation, God's glory, changes everything. This is the first fill in the blank for you. We need a revelation of God that transcends our human emotions. Now, I realize there are a lot of people in the church, I just kind of describe them as saved, satisfied, and petrified. It's like I heard somebody say, you know, there's a problem with pillars in the church. You can't get them to move. And there are people who will come into a service and say, I dare you, preacher, to get to me. I would say that if we don't have an emotional response towards God, we haven't had much of an encounter with God. But I have to also be honest that my emotions have highs and they have lows. If you have an emotional high, you will have a low. If you're in a low, don't worry. They're going to come. Our emotions fluctuate. We can't live by our emotions, but boy, when the blessings and the joy come, we enjoy it. Amen? But we need a revelation of God that goes beyond my level of emotions. Because I can't live on those emotions. I have to have a revelation of God that I hold on to, that I see, that I keep before me when I'm up on the high and when I'm down in the low. You tracking with me? It's what we need desperately. I saw something years ago, and I think sometimes people get tired of hearing me say it, but it is so real to me that revelation brings illumination that results in transformation. When I get a revelation of God, his light of truth shines into the darkness of my life and illuminates those dark places. And as that Holy Spirit shines into my life through his word, it relates to me. It leads to me then being transformed. My brain's about two paragraphs ahead of my mouth. I'm sorry. Such a powerful thing. We desperately need a revelation from God. I like what Paul said. He's writing to the Galatians, and you may remember this when we were going through the book of Galatians, maybe it was 2 years ago. I just thought, I almost said just a little while ago, but then we spent a year in Romans and a year in the Gospel of John. So sometime back, we went through the book of Galatians. Paul writes to the Galatians, chapter 1, verse 11. He said, I'd have you know, brethren, that the gospel which was preached by me is not according to man, for I neither received it from man, nor was I taught it, but I received it through a revelation of Jesus Christ. When God takes away the veil that is over our eyes, and we get a revelation of his word, we get a revelation of Jesus Christ, everything changes. Now, I'm not about against education. I believe we need education. You need all the education you need to do what God's called you to do. Amen? And for some of us, that's more than others. But you see, all the education is of little value if you don't have that revelation of Jesus Christ. I want to suggest to us in our time together that remains three things about a revelation of God and His glory. Number one, God's glory changes our relationship with Him. That's a fill in the blank. You remember back when we were in Exodus 33, Moses says to God, "Show me your glory." We didn't talk a whole lot about it on that Sunday, and I forget which one of us was preaching, it doesn't matter. But what's important is God's glory does not come with flashes of lightning and peals of thunder. There wasn't a shaking of the ground beneath the feet of Moses. Instead, God's glory came to him as a simple revelation. Exodus 34, 6 and 7 says, "The Lord passed before him and proclaimed, 'The Lord, the Lord God, merciful and gracious, long-suffering, abundant in goodness, in truth, keeping mercy for thousands, forgiving iniquity and transgression.'" Just let that sink in. We are a generation, we are a society that is addicted to its own adrenaline. That's why I say we need a revelation of God from His Word by the Holy Spirit in our hearts that transcends our emotions because we are addicted to our own adrenaline. And unless I have a rush, well, it's not happening. And my level of spirituality depends on my emotional level today. See, when you live by your emotions, you're in deep trouble. If that's what controls your life, you're in trouble. Because if you're on an emotional high, glory to God. If you're on an emotional low, where's God? But when we get this revelation, if we are on an emotional high, we're able to say, "Hallelujah, I'm going to enjoy this." If we're on a low, we're saying, "Glory to God, He's still God." Can you see and hear the difference here? It is profoundly important. When God reveals His glory to His people, it's for a purpose. God allowed Moses to see His glory so that he could change his understanding of it. I like what David Wilkerson said, the late David Wilkerson. We actually sang about this morning. David Wilkerson said, "God reveals His glory to us so that we may be reassured in our daily walk." Like Moses, you and I need divine reassurance. We need assurance that Jesus really is the fullness, the one in whom the fullness of God dwells. And He dwells in us by faith, and He has promised, "I'll never, never, never," say never, "never leave you or forsake you." That's why so many people love some of these old songs. I thought about the song that Janice and I recorded and we've sung so many times. You know it. "And He walks with me, and He talks with me, and He tells me what? I am His own, and the joy we share as we tarry there, none other has ever known." Now that part isn't exactly true, because when you experience the presence of the Lord, you know what I'm talking about when I sing those words. There's a reason that songs like that just draw us. because there's something that longs for that. I get so excited as I look into the scripture. When you think about what Adam and Eve lost in Genesis chapter 3 because of sin, and God in his mercy put them out of the Garden of Eden. That was not judgment. That was his mercy, because God said, let us put man out of the garden, lest he take and eat of the tree of life and live forever. He'd already eaten of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. So here he was in sin. Can you imagine if man would have eaten of the tree of life, he would have been trapped eternally in that sinful state. It was God's mercy that put Adam and Eve out of the garden until the Redeemer could come. That'd be a good time to say amen. Thank you, Lord. See, God's glory, his presence in our lives, changes our relationship. I think it's interesting when you get into Revelation, what is it? Is it 22, where it talks about the river of life that comes from the throne of God, and on either side of the tree, of the river, is the tree of life, whose leaves are for the healing of the nations. You see, what's coming is not just a restoration of what Adam and Eve had and lost in the garden, but it is a greater fulfillment. They couldn't eat of the tree of life, but oh, today you and I are eating from the living word. And in Revelation, there's going to be a fulfillment as we eat of the tree of life eternally with the Lord God. I cannot imagine what that's going to be like. So it changes our relationship with God. Number two, it changes our countenance. Do you realize that a person's countenance is often the best expression outwardly of what's in their heart? By the way, did you know, physiological fact, it takes fewer facial muscles for you to smile than it does for you to frown? They also tell me that the older we get, our faces tend to become fixed with the expression that is normative to us. Over the years, I joked and I said, my goal is to have a permanent Jimmy Carter. Some of you are old enough to know who Jimmy Carter is. Others of you, you need to find out. Exodus 34 and verse 35 says that the children of Israel saw that the face of Moses, the skin of his face, shone. He'd spent 40 days up on the mountain with God. Can you imagine that? I can't. And here's the amazing thing. Moses doesn't even know that his countenance has changed. So often, you and I don't recognize by looking in the mirror that our countenance has changed, but other people see it. You see, the face of Moses was simply reflecting the glory of God that had filled his soul. Now, we know from Scripture that that glory that was on Moses was a fading glory. And the same is true for us. That's why we need to constantly be in the Word. But do you realize, I love this, from 1 John chapter 1 and verse 1. I think we have the slide for you. That which was from the beginning, which we heard, which we've seen with our eyes, which we've looked at, and our hands have handled of the word of life. John 1:14, and the word became, say it, flesh, and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory. Glory as the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. Can you begin to see that as we daily spend time with Jesus, as we're basking in his presence, as we're going through our day conscious of his presence with us, his glory begins to fill our soul and is reflected through our lives. Paul said it this way, 2 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 18. but we all, say all. This is all of us, not just the preachers, not just the elders. This is all of us with unveiled face, beholding as in a mirror the glory of the Lord, are being transformed into the same image from glory to glory to glory to glory. I'm putting in a couple of extra glories. Just as from the Lord the Spirit. We're being changed. Our countenance is being changed. I don't think I have this up on the slide for you, but jot down this scripture reference, 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 6. Let the weight of this word sink into your heart. For God who said, "Let light shall shine out of darkness," is the one who has shown in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Christ. Oh, church, as we practice the presence of God, it changes us. Years ago, I started to pray a prayer every morning, and now I get up and my spirit just kind of prays it. Oh, God, make me conscious of your presence with me today. Show me the little things that you're doing in my life. Make me sensitive to the needs of the people that I meet. And help me to just say one word to point them to you. That prayer, folks, has changed my life. Life has become an adventure for me because I'm so aware of his presence. And it becomes an adventure. God, who am I going to meet today? Who am I going to have a conversation with today? And when I do meet, something just begins to trigger inside of me. Holy Spirit, what's going on in their life? How can I encourage them? How can I point them to you? It has changed my life. One of the highest compliments I ever received was in a very spiritual place called the Fast Lane in Topeka, Indiana. For a time, I'd go in there and get a cup of coffee, a takeout. And one day, I walked in there, and the person working in there, and I can't even tell you who it was anymore, but I go to pay for it, and that person said, "I love it when you come in here, because I feel Jesus." I wanted to cry. I want to weep now. I said, "Oh, Lord Jesus. I don't think about stuff like that." And I'm challenged in my heart when people encounter me. Do they feel Jesus? Do they see Jesus? Am I representing him well? Because as I spend time in his presence, my countenance changes. And I can tell you, if Janice was here, she could tell you that when I'm under stress and I am grumpy, it's because I haven't been basking in the presence of his word. I spend so much time in the word looking for things for you that I don't spend enough time in the word for me, just basking in his presence. See, some of these things are painful because they reveal my own heart. Number three, God's glory, and you can see this coming, this is a fill in the blank, it changes our relationship with others. When we receive a revelation of God's glory, we begin to understand what it means to taste of his love, his mercy, and forgiveness. I think it's an interesting thing. If you read and study the life of Paul, in the early days of his ministry, he would say, "I'm the least of the apostles." But do you know what he said about himself towards the end of his life and ministry? "I'm the chief of sinners." What changed? What changed was he was no longer comparing himself to others, only to the Lord Jesus. And spending time with the Lord Jesus, the more we spend time with him, the more we see the wickedness of our own hearts. And as I recognize his mercy and grace, I am a terrible person. I am capable of doing anything but for the grace of God. And so are you. And the more we spend time in his presence, the more we compare ourselves with him. Because after all, if I compare myself with some of you, well, hey. Come on, now I make a joke, but isn't that what we do? But when I spend time with him, I'm not comparing myself to you. It's to him. And so, Lord Jesus, how could you ever love someone like me? Why? In all of your glorious universe or universes, would you give your life for somebody like me? You see, just as Christ has extended undeserved grace to people like you and me, we begin to extend grace to people who are around us, who don't deserve us. I'm convinced, and I'll only speak in my own life, you apply this to yours, but I'm convinced there's a direct correlation between how much grace I extend to others and how much of the glory of God I'm experiencing within my own heart on a daily basis. And that becomes painful realization for me, because after all, some of the things that some people say and do, I have a right to be upset. I have a right to be outraged. But it's a reflection of the fact that I haven't been spending time basking in the glory of God through his word and by his spirit. Because now I have allowed things to be focused on me. You see, once we receive this revelation of God's glory, we can't continue in the old pattern of how we treat people. Everything has to change. And I'll tell you, it's a struggle. Do you realize that if you take a pin and you jab it into a dead body, it doesn't scream? And every time something gets jabbed into me and I scream, it's a reminder that my flesh isn't dead. Like I said, what I'm sharing with you today is deeply personal and in some respects painful, because I see my own reactions. And I'm saying, oh God, do something in me. Can you understand, in the light of this revelation of God's glory, why Paul would write to the Ephesians in chapter 4 and verse 31 and say, let all bitterness, all wrath and anger and clamor and evil speaking be put away from you with all malice, and be kind to one another, tenderhearted, forgiving one another, even as God for Christ's sake has forgiven you. See, to understand glory is to understand God, his nature and his character, to understand what he's done. It's not some emotional, spiritual high, some spiritual spectacular with flames and sounds and all sorts of special effects. I read something by Henry Blackaby. I'm almost done here. Stick with me. Henry Blackaby said this: what an incredible witness it is to a lost and fearful society when the Christian acts like a child of God, living under loving sovereignty of the Heavenly Father. Just let that sink in. John MacArthur said, And we really need to pray for John MacArthur and that congregation in California. What the Los Angeles County is doing is wrong. What the judge ruled the other day is wrong. We won't get into that, but here's what John MacArthur said. A godly life gives convincing testimony of the saving power of God, and that brings him glory. Now, I grew up in an Amish Mennonite culture, in a Mennonite church, and we allowed that truth, that we live our life as a testimony, to become an excuse why we didn't talk to people about Jesus. So we're not going there with what I'm saying, but there is something, because the community is watching. They're watching your life. Do you realize that you are the only Bible that most of the world will ever read? And as they look at your life, in their minds, they're saying, that's what a Christian looks like. That's what it means to live like a Christian. Worship team, come and join me as we close. God's glory is a revelation of his character, his divine nature, his eternal attributes. These pieces of furniture, the ark, the mercy seat, the table of showbread, the golden candlestick, the altar of incense, they're all a reflection of God, and they are a foreshadowing of Jesus Christ, our great high priest. As you read through chapter 37, I want you to notice something. At least seven times, this passage states that these things were made of pure gold. What's going on in our lives, church, is that God is purifying us. And do you know how gold is purified? It's purified by fire. They heat it up, and it becomes molten. And they tell me that in this process, as they heat it up, it becomes molten, and impurities come to the surface, and they skim those off. Then you know what they do? They turn up the heat a little more. And different impurities come to the surface, and those are skimmed off. And then they heat it up a little more. How many of you like it when things get hot? Not me. And different impurities come to the surface. They tell me that they continue this process of heating and increasing the heat and skimming off the impurities until the refiner can see his reflection in that molten gold. Does that give you an idea of what God is doing in your life and in mine? And if I have a revelation of his glory, when he turns up the heat, it's easier. I'm not saying it's easy. I'm saying it's easier to say, thank you, Lord, for your refining me so that my life can clearly reflect your glory. When God chooses to show his glory, it's a revelation of how he wants us to reflect his life to a lost and dying world. Our problem is, like the children of Israel, we hear the word, then we wrestle and rebel against the word, when what we need to do is obey it. Matt Chandler said this, People who hear the word, believe the word, and do the word are unleashed on the world to do hard things. Jesus said, let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father is in heaven. Church, I believe the challenge for us today is to take that glory and shine it on the world around us. It's time to act in love as Christ has acted, as the Lord pours out his love on us and through us. We didn't sing it this morning, but I kept thinking of the song that Matt wrote a number of years ago, one of my favorites, Let Your Glory Shine. Let your glory shine here in this place. Stand together with me. Father, thank you for your living word. Lord, as we look into your word, it forces us to look into our lives and to see all the wickedness, all the things in our lives that need a change and that need to go. We realize that so often we are just like the children of Israel who hear your word and then rebel against it. God, may we be a people who hear your word and who joyfully obey it. Lord, give us a revelation that brings illumination, that results in transformation, so that we may reflect your life, your light, and your glory to this lost and dying world. May your glory change our relationship with you. May your glory change our countenance, and may it change our attitudes as we relate to others. We pray this for your glory, because we know it's also for our good, but most of all for your glory. In Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen.
Let's just respond to this by asking and answering the question, yeah, but is it worth it? Because I think most of us have gone through really tough times, and when you're in the midst of it, you say, yeah, but is all that really worth it? And the answer is, God is.
Does our God intend seal and open the scroll. Lion of Judah, who conquered the grave. Oh, he is David's root and Lamb who died to ransom the slave. From every people and tribe, from every nation and tongue, he has made us a kingdom and priests to God to reign with the Son. Is he worthy? Is he worthy of all blessing and honor and glory? And is he worthy? Is he worthy? Is he worthy?
Remind you that if you brought an offering to the Lord, we have boxes here and in the back. I encourage you to do that. Also, if you can put up the Family Talk slide, if it's possible. I want to encourage you, it's in your bulletin for those of you who are here. Take some time today where you sit down together, read through chapter 37 together. Talk about the Ark of the Covenant, the mercy seat, the table of showbread and the golden candlestick. What did each of them represent? How did they speak of Jesus? Why is it important to us? Talk about how does or how should God's glory change us, our relationship with Him, our countenance, and our relationship with others. And then finally, take time to pray together, asking God for forgiveness, maybe confessing to one another in a family where your attitude is really stunk because you've not been spending time with God. His glory hasn't been shining into your heart, and you realize that's why your attitude has been so bad. But ask for forgiveness where you've rebelled against God's word, and for grace to walk in faithfulness and obedience. Matt, have you got anything else before we're dismissed? Lift up your hands, receive the blessing of the Lord. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May He lift up His countenance upon you, the glory of His presence, and be gracious unto you. May He bless you and make you a blessing for Jesus' sake. Amen. God bless you. The peace of the Lord be with you. You are dismissed. See you.